Thank you, Chair. First of all, I would like to thank the NIAS authorities for having called me to NIAS, and it's my first visit here. It's such a pleasure to be here attending this conference, which has seen so much of discussion, and primarily because of Dr. Mail, and unfortunately, he is not well, and I do hope that Dr. Mail gets well soon. We've had very enriching discussion, and particularly I was delighted to hear the previous speaker present his opinions on India-Myanmar relations. Myanmar, I think, is an underrated neighbor with potential to influence India's vital strategic and economic interests. I think India and Myanmar have many issues and concerns, and as far as our India-Myanmar policy is concerned, we have many objectives in mind. We have also certain means of achieving those objectives. How far we have been successful needs to be analyzed. But at the moment, India-Myanmar relations have converged on a certain issues. The most recent was, of course, on the border. And to be successful, you know, in terms of our Myanmar policy, the Modi government will need to look both within and without. That means to the internal policy of and also the external policy. It will have to factor in and take into account primarily the northeastern region in its Act East policy, which it has framed. Previous governments have attempted to prioritize the Myanmar policy with varying results, from outright differences to joint military operations. India-Myanmar relations have traversed the entire spectrum. They have seen many ups and downs. But the India-Myanmar relations have always been very cordial because they are rooted, as the minister very rightly said, in our deep cultural and historical links. Myanmar's transition to democracy has added a new dimension to India's relations with its closest ASEAN neighbor. Myanmar's new experiment with democracy is little over 4 years old, having installed a civilian government in 2011. The 2008 constitution is currently in place, and the country will go to polls in November 2015. Myanmar's transition has been marked by a series of developments, and they have been at the national level, at the regional level, and also globally. India is watching Myanmar with keen interest because it is our next door neighbor and borders four of our northeastern states. It is the only Southeast Asian country with which we have a land border. Its geostrategic importance has often been emphasized. As far as our Lookies policy is concerned, we introduced it in the early 1990s, and now the Lookies policy is progressing through various phases. It could justifiably claim some credit for the change of heart of Western nations in abandoning their policy of boycott and sanctions against Myanmar. Just as the Lookies policy is said to have progressed to Lookies policy phase 3, time has now come for India's Myanmar policy to move to India-Myanmar policy phase 3, parallel to the Look East policy, which has now entered the Act East policy phase. In India-Myanmar policy phase 1, India's support in 1988 and after the to the democratic movement, a big wedge was created between Yangon and Delhi. In the phase 2 of India's Myanmar policy, we realized that to engage the regime in power is very important, and therefore we began to engage the regime in power. This now is the phase when it is the right time for closer interactions, as the phase 3 is the advanced, if not mature, phase of the relationship, where it is important to lay down the rules of engagement with Myanmar and follow them in order to ensure that the trust levels are kept up. Because there is a danger that if we are not careful, our best of friends may we could have some difference of opinion. Some might argue that these efforts are not worth it, that the Myanmar government has not democratized enough, or that its ethnic conflicts remain yet unresolved, or that the constitution has not been amended, or that the Myanmar government did not show sufficient resolve in expelling some insurgent groups. But such arguments underestimate Myanmar's friendly approach towards India and a constant relationship between India and Myanmar. Put simply, what happens in Myanmar will not be limited to Myanmar. From China's maritime quest in the Bay of Bengal, India's energy quest, development needs of India's northeastern region, managing China's regional and global challenge, and Myanmar's own development requirements, we need to manage India and Myanmar relationship to the best of our ability. Achieving India's objectives in Myanmar is therefore very important. There are various ways of, various means of achieving these objectives. Our objectives are to be achieved through diplomatic means, economic means, cultural and military diplomacy. Through diplomacy, we have seen that at the bilateral level and at the multilateral level, India and Myanmar have been very close. At the bilateral level, right through the phase of transition, we have seen official visits between India and Myanmar. India has been a bit of a laggard, but Prime Minister Narendra Modi seized the opportunity to visit Myanmar when the multilateral occasion presented itself recently in the form of East Asia Summit in Naypyidaw, while External Affairs Minister Sushma Swaraj also visited Myanmar recently. At the 12th ASEAN-India Summit, Prime Minister Modi declared, externally, India's Look East policy has become Act East policy. He further indicated that Bangladesh is an integral part of the Act East policy. Earlier, of course, Dr. Manmohan Singh had visited Myanmar in 2012. It was the first visit of Indian Prime Minister after a long period of 25 years. During that visit, Dr. Singh had met the new civilian leadership in the new capital, Naypyidaw, and the NLD leader also in the old capital, Yangon. The Indian Prime Minister's visit almost coincided with Aung San Suu Kyi's visit to Bangkok, which was also after about 24 years. But Aung San Suu Kyi met the former Prime Minister as well. At the multilateral level also, we have had many cooperative endeavors. But before I mention about the multilateral engagements, I would like to mention that during Prime Minister Manmohan Singh's visit, an agreement, an MOU was signed in which my institute, Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis, and Myanmar Institute of Strategic Studies, to which Minister also belongs, we signed an MOU for cooperation. And similarly, the Indian Council of World Affairs, to which Dr. Pankaj Jha belongs, also signed an MOU with Myanmar Institute of Strategic Studies. That shows the level of understanding that actually exists between the two countries at an academic and think tank level. At the multilateral level, India and Myanmar have been cooperating not only in ASEAN forums, but also in BIMSTEC, Mekong Ganga Cooperation Forum, and SAARC, where Myanmar is an observer member. Myanmar, of course, as mentioned earlier, became member of BIMSTEC in 1997. At the same time, it became member of ASEAN. India has, of course, a number of strategic imperatives in Myanmar. India's interest in Myanmar can be explained in terms of that country's enormous strategic importance. We share about 1643 kilometers of long border with Myanmar, and of course a very long maritime boundary as well. India wants Myanmar to ensure that the area west of Chindwin River remains free of Chinese or Pakistani influence. Four states in India's northeast border, Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Manipur and Mizoram, are bordering Myanmar. Similarly, three Myanmar states border India, Kachin, Sagaing and Chin. Secondly, it is important to seek stability in the northeastern border by ensuring economic prosperity in those areas which are yet to develop properly. Thirdly, Myanmar's border with Bangladesh to its northwest is also crucial from India's perspective because it provides an alternative route and a crucial one to Myanmar and Southeast Asia. Here it is important to remember that northeast, through which the route to Myanmar traverses, is only tenuously linked by the chicken neck, which we all know about. We need to curb drug trafficking and smuggling. Myanmar shares land border with other major Asian powers, power which is China. Myanmar shares border with two other Southeast Asian states, Thailand and Laos to its east. Both India and China understand Myanmar's maritime significance. Myanmar's coast on the Bay of Bengal and the southwest in the Andaman Sea is strategically very significant. It is in close proximity to India's Andaman and Nicobar Islands. The two countries also maintain close military-to-military contacts and exchange regular high-level visits. Myanmar has often come into prominence because of our very turbulent border sometimes because of insurgency problems. On May 8, 2014, India's ambassador to Myanmar, Mr. Mukhopadhyay, and Major General Chor Nyunt, Deputy Defense Minister of Myanmar, signed an important MOU on border cooperation. Its provisions included a framework of security cooperation and exchange of information between India and Myanmar security agencies. There were certain other elements to it, but I won't go through that. Perhaps this MOU was helpful in tackling with the recent problems that we faced on our border. And that is why a constant interaction at the border through the security forces is so very important. It plays a very important role for India in tackling insurgency problems. Which have been a source of concern for both countries. And the problem has often been aggravated by the fact that people of the same ethnic community are found across the border. The two armies have cooperated closely in the past as well. We know of the Operation Golden Bird, which happened in July 1995, which was a partial success but failed because of certain reasons to come to its logical conclusion. Later, the two sides have held discussions in Kalemyo, Myanmar in November 2001, and the Myanmar army arrested some 40 Manipur insurgents when it raided three underground camps at Tamu, Namphalong and Khanjao near the Manipur border. These insurgents belong to United Nations Liberation, People's Liberation Army and People's Revolutionary Party of Kanglipak. The point that I'm trying to make is that in the past also the Myanmar army has cooperated with the Indian army in dealing with some of our insurgent problems in the northeast. There are other imperatives that India has in Myanmar, economic imperatives. India's Lukis policy and its policy of liberalization, as we know, almost coincided. Both began at the same time in the early 1990s. The Lukis policy was aimed externally and the liberalization policy was aimed within the country. A stable economy is a necessary precondition for a stable government. Though the Thein Sein government administers a country with considerable natural resources, it is still categorized as an LDC country with a low per capita income. The GDP growth, however, has been increasing in the recent years in Myanmar. And Myanmar has shown very much sustained economic growth in the recent past because of an inflow of large foreign investment. But it is feared that increased imports will lead to increased current account deficit. This is perhaps one of the fears that economists have expressed. Also, although the National League for Democracy has not spelled out its economic policy priorities, were it to come to power after November elections, it would gain from the expected enhanced external engagement and foreign aid which would come in. Myanmar's GDP, according to EIU estimates, is expected to grow at 6.8% in this year. As a consequence, the trade has suffered, and we need to connect the northeast of India to the business centers of Southeast Asia. Here it is very important to remember that the infrastructure in Northeast India is as backward as the infrastructure in Sagaing province of Myanmar because of the colonial policy that were followed by Britain when they ruled both India and Myanmar and Burma. As far as roads are concerned, as the infrastructure, there was a flawed logic employed earlier that safety lies in not building the road or not building roads because it is increasingly a security threat. But that logic was flawed, and steps are being taken to overcome that kind of approach. India has helped Myanmar build roads so that surface transport gives a boost to trade and tourism. Third, it is our only road link to Southeast Asia. India has a long border with Myanmar, which has become ASEAN member. First, it is important to have economic linkages, then trade and commerce will grow. On the one hand, these states are in the grip of law and order problems, and on the other, they have somehow been left out of national mainstream. India's former External Affairs Minister, Mr. Jaswant Singh, had inaugurated the Friendship Road, which is 160 kilometers long and starts from Manipur More Tamu Road, which goes up to Kalemyo. The road link to Myanmar is important for at least three reasons: as a link to rest of Southeast Asia, and in order to tackle insurgency, and also for economic reasons. As far as the other linkages, connectivity linkages are concerned, there is the Trans-Asian Railway, which is important and which will be built up, and important to have also air connectivity to Myanmar towns. China has already developed linkages from its towns to major cities of Myanmar, and I think it is important for the two friendly countries to establish linkages, especially because we have a number of Buddhist sites in India where tourists from Myanmar would like to come, and tourists from other parts of Southeast Asia would also like to be there. Trade. We have signed the ASEAN-India Free Trade Agreement, and that would mean slashing of duties on many products from Myanmar. Trade relations are bound to be growing, and what is required is that border trade should also equally grow between India and Myanmar. Ever since the border trade agreement was signed 1994. We have seen more border posts open up on our northeastern border. We have land customs stations in Arunachal. As far as Nagaland is concerned, it has been agreed to open. Manipur, Mizoram. As far as aid is concerned, for economic recovery, a resumption of aid from multilateral agencies is the key, according to certain agencies, and trade consultancy is required. There is a lot of scope equally for tourism to grow between India and Myanmar. As far as investment is concerned, Myanmar has begun to attract considerable investment after the opening up. Myanmar government has liberalized its foreign investment laws, and the impact of flood of investment into Myanmar had an impact on India too, which slipped from being the 10th largest investor to the 11th largest investor in Myanmar, with an approved investment of $508 million out of total estimated of a much larger investment to Myanmar. India has mainly invested in the oil and gas sector. Policymakers in New Delhi were concerned that the increased Chinese participation in infrastructure projects in Myanmar could have an adverse impact on India's security. Myanmar too expressed misgivings about a Chinese stranglehold over its economy. In fact, Myanmar has distributed development of its important projects among the major powers. India's business needs to be more aggressive in maintaining its presence in Myanmar. Myanmar's British legacy of English language, an effective legal system, and in already existing patent and copyright law are expected to attract foreign investors. On the energy front, also, we need to pursue our linkages in Myanmar. Concerns do persist between India and Myanmar, and these concerns relate to some issues which need urgent attention. Concerns emanating from Myanmar are regarding the insurgent camps which are in Myanmar, where safe havens are. Of course, Myanmar government is attending to most of our Indian concerns regarding that. There are certain pending border demarcation issues as well. Another important pending issue is the Rohingya problem, which does impact us, as the Mahabodhi temple attack showed. The Meitei diaspora in Myanmar is beset by contradictions, which also need to be addressed by India. Problems emanating from China include, during that period that India took the approach of not dealing with the military in power, we paid dearly as China filled the vacuum in terms of influence. There was a significant rise in Chinese footprint in Myanmar. Chinese influence in Myanmar and support to Indian insurgent groups is also a concern. And then Chinese access to the Indian Ocean is also raising some security concerns. And of course, threats like insurgency, maritime piracy, cross-border small arms and drugs smuggling, and human trafficking are other concerning issues. Our involvement in Myanmar cannot be a zero-sum game with China. This is something that I would like to reassert. We need to have constructive engagement with Myanmar, and that also includes engaging China as well. Concerns emanating from India's northeast include insurgency and developmental concerns. As far as the way forward is concerned, Myanmar goes to the polls this year in November. Whatever be the election results in Myanmar, the strategic and economic concerns of Delhi and Naypyidaw will converge, as my observations have tried to bring out. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Udai Bhanu Singh. On the Rohingya issue, within India, there is a clear-cut, you know, difference opinion. Because Rohingyas for us might be not that economically, you know, enticing ethnic group. And moreover, Rohingyas, we don't really take care as a major economic or social issue for us. Because Rohingyas as such have very dark, shady, grays area in which there are a number of articles which have been written. So from my personal perspective, I don't believe that Rohingya will be a major issue for us, typically with regard to bilateral relations between India and Burma.